you identify the disease, if you study it, know it, learn how to test for it, learn how dangerous it is, maybe this will create inside you a motivation, a drive to make genuine repentance from this problem before Eid. Because if Eid comes and this disease is still there, إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. The first disease we talk about, my brothers and my sisters, and the most dangerous disease, and the nucleus and core of every single problem we have in our life, is love of dunya. This disease, حب الدنيا, رأس كل خطيئة. This disease is the disease of the religious brothers and sisters. When I say to you, oh, mashallah, he's a religious brother. What do you look for? What are the, you know, what are the pointers you're looking for? How do you call someone a religious brother? How? What makes you say that? You see Ibid, see Abaya, mashallah. You see, mashallah, wearing a sunnah cap or a amama, even, you know, more religious. You know? You see him, mashallah, in the masjid. Maybe praying salah in the masjid, mashallah. Maybe working in da'wah, maybe giving lectures. But the majority of these things, my brothers and my sisters, are a facade. They're easy fixes. These things, you can bring a guy off the street, a drug dealer, you know, drug dealer. And within 1 week, you know, when we first opened Bukhari House, one of the big drug dealers in the area came one day to the shop, all tatted up. And then, you know, I thought at the beginning he's not Muslim, like, you know, there's no sign of Islam at all. He came, he asked me a question. He goes, oh, this. I started talking to him. Realized he's Muslim, started speaking for a bit, he liked the conversation. I go, we have a musalla at the back, come join us, this, that. Full drug dealer, huh? Like big time. He came, joined. After a few days, he bought a abaya from the shop. His beard started to grow, all right? I don't want to mention his name. But within 1 week, people were calling him Sheikh Fulan. I'm not joking, wallah. I'm not exaggerating. Khalas. He has all the identifiers of a religious brother. The guy's a full drug dealer. But he's with us in the masjid. He's alhamdulillah, very nice brother. He's crying, you know. But within 1 week, people started saying, Sheikh Fulan. Yeah, meet for Hawaii brother. Yeah, mashallah, he's a good religious brother. Very easy to change this outside. But the problems that are inside, they're very, very hard to deal with. You can be 20 years on deen, 30 years on deen, 50 years on deen. Khuruj, a'mal, tahajjud, Quran. But your heart is a dunya addict. Your heart loves dunya. Your focus, your priority, your purpose of life, all dunya based. This is the biggest disease the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is facing. And this is the disease you will not repent from. This i'tikaf, you will come to i'tikaf, you will park your AMG in Erie Street because they said no parking here. And you have plans, mashallah, to buy a better car after Eid. And mashallah, you're making dua in i'tikaf, in sujood. Ya Allah, please make this halal company accept my mortgage application because I want to buy a $1 million house. And then you'll go to the Sheikh and say, Sheikh, please make dua, man, I want my application to be accepted. And it will go through. You won't even feel guilty. You won't even feel that there's a problem. Halal, 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 halal. This is why, my brothers and my sisters, we have to start from this point so that everyone knows where he stands. The biggest fitna of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is dunya. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم إن لكل أمة فتنة. Every ummah has a fitna. Every ummah has a special weakness. وفتنة أمة المال. And the fitna of my ummah is money. We love money. We love money and we love what money buys. And we are addicted. And it defines our character. And it defines our life. Not only are we, especially people here in Australia, are we dunya addicts. No, no, no. We are dunya junkies. We are muhajireen, muhajireen, you know? We are the muhajireen of dunya. Not only are you an average guy born in your country that loves dunya, no, no, no. 99% of us did hijrah for dunya. You know what hijrah for dunya does? You know what migration for dunya does? Migration for dunya makes your heart vicious, hungry. This is why you see a new import when it comes to Australia. Dollar signs are written on his forehead. He just arrived, you know, he just got his PR. And all what he's thinking of is the dog race. Yalla bu'a, khalas bu'a, have to make it. My friend came 1 year before me and look where he is now. Family's competing. Your nice wife, mashallah, who's in niqab. Who's mashallah taking your kids to the Quran school every morning. Waking up for tahajjud. She's a dunya lover. She's an addict. Her heart is sick. Your heart is sick. And unfortunately, you will stand in 3 hour salah. You will make a million tawbah and istighfar to Allah Azza wa Jal. But this thought will not even cross your mind. I'm alright, brother. Actually, I want more dunya. Marad. Bimar, sickness. It needs to be analyzed, needs to be emphasized, needs to be discussed. Ala hal ballaght. My brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for akhirah. We were created by Allah not for dunya. We were created by Allah for akhirah. Akhirah is the target and goal and worry and concern of every single believer. You have real iman, you have any form of iman, akhirah should be your target. And dunya should be the least of your concerns. Because by definition, dunya is short, cheap, and has no value. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم ما الدنيا في الآخرة. This dunya compared to the آخرة إلا مثل ما يجعل أحدكم أصبعه في اليم فلينظر بما يرجع. This dunya compared to the hereafter is exactly like when one of you drives to the ocean and dips his finger in the ocean and takes it out again. What comes up with his finger? A drop from the ocean, and after 2 minutes you can't find the drop. But where is the drop that I got? I went there, I drove to Brighton and I got a drop of water. Where is it gone? 2 minutes, finished. No more drop. It dries. Our teacher, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our role model, our love, Habibi ya Rasulullah, and we sing nasheed and naat about how much we love him and how amazing he was. Our names are Muhammad's and our clothes are like him. But he's saying that dunya is a drop in the ocean and the ocean is akhirah. Is this really how we feel in our heart? Uqsim billano. I take oath by Allah. This is not the case of your heart. Stop lying to yourself. Stop even saying, Allah, dunya means nothing to me, because you're a liar. You're fake and you're a liar and you're lying to yourself before anyone else. We love dunya. Dunya has become the purpose of our life. Dunya has become the aim of our existence. Dunya defines your day. Dunya defines your night. Dunya defines your mood. When dunya comes, you're happy, you're cheerful, you're excited, you're motivated. When dunya goes, you're depressed in the corner in the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the authentic hadith, لو كانت if لو كانت الدنيا تعدل عند الله جناح بعوضة. If this dunya, if it doesn't, it's not, but if this dunya was equivalent to one wing of a mosquito, one, not two. Two wings are good, they make the mosquito fly. But imagine the example the Prophet ﷺ is giving. He is talking about a mosquito with one wing, trying a harab to do these ones to get up and nothing is happening. If this dunya, with its cars and businesses and jewelry and brands and watches and clothes and status and honor and rank and competition, if this dunya was equivalent to one wing of a mosquito, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not give a non-Muslim a sip of water in it. Kuffar would not get a sharbat ma, a sip of water. Allah won't give them. They don't deserve it. But Allah Azza wa Jal is giving the kuffar billions of dollars. Allah gave them mansions and palaces and na'im and luxury. And why, my brothers and sisters? Why? Because dunya has no, it has no value. It has no value in the sight of Allah. It had no value to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No value. It is equal to turab. A Ferrari and dust should have the same effect on your heart. $1 million double story house in Auburn in front of the masjid. Because religious brothers don't buy any house. They buy the house close to the masjid.
MashaAllah, Udeen.
A big double story 2024 built house, mashallah, brand new. When a believer looks at it, he should see what? What should he see? Dust, turab. If this is not the state of your heart, you don't believe Allah. You don't believe Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You don't believe them. It's unseen. But Allah is telling you, imagine this. Look at the hypocrisy we read. Look at the fakeness. You say, Ya Allah, I believe you, Allah. La ilaha illallah. I love you, Allah. You are al-alim. You are the most knowledgeable. You are al-hakim. You are the most wise. But ya Allah, if you give me information, I don't believe you. Is that iman? Do you believe now or you don't believe? But either Allah knows or Allah doesn't know. Either Muhammad knows or Muhammad does not know. What is it exactly in your heart? Do they know or don't they know? If they know and you know that they know and you believe what they say, then when you look at a Ferrari, you should see turab. You should see dust. But is that what your heart sees? Is that what your heart sees? How about $1 million? Imagine that, $1 million in cash in a suitcase. Ya Baba. Ya Baba, yeah, what people do. People see greens and the eyes and face light up, wallahi. We love dunya, my brothers. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once walking through the market. One day, him and his companions, the famous hadith. As he's walking sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered the market, and the quality of the marketplace is the center of dunya, the shopping center. And this is where the tawaf happens. Where does tawaf happen in Sydney? Where? In the aisles of shops. Every day your wife does tawaf. She goes into the shop with the intention of buying one item. She comes out the other side with a trolley full. What happened? I don't know, Allah. I found this cheap, and I found this on a, you know, special, and I found this, and I found that. Dunya. خَيْرُ بِقَاعِ الْأَرْضِ الْمَسَاجِدِ. The best places on earth are the mosques. وَشَرُّهَا الْأَسْوَاقِ. And the worst places on earth are the markets. The places of buying and selling of dunya. In one narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فِيهَا يَعْقِدُ الشَّيْطَانُ لِوَاءَهُ. This is where shaitan installs his post. You know, like, this is my territory. When you go to Woolies, remember, next time you're entering Shaitan's zone. You know, Shaitan has put his flag. Westfields, my place, dunya. In the other narration, قال صلى الله عليه وسلم فيها باض الشيطان وفرخ. In the market, Shaitan lays his eggs and the eggs hatch. And this is the air. That's the breeding point of Shayateen. That's the hive of Shaitan. That's where he's hanging out. And this is where the average Muslim spends, you know, this is what we call town center. What's our town center? What is it? The masjid? No, the masjid is locked. The masjid is locked all day. What town center? If you enter the masjid one day and you find a brother, you know, let's say between Fajr and Dhuhr in the mosque, 9 o'clock. What's the natural conversation? Imagine I walk in and I find Masjid al-Nur, a brother is there at 9 o'clock in the morning. What do I say? Brother, do you need a lift? The natural assumption is, what the hell are you doing here? Not Salah time. Our mosques are closed. But the market is 24 hours now. And alhamdulillah, with technology, preparation for Dajjal, Shaitan decided to invade your own privacy. So now, you don't need to go to the shop. The shop came to your home. The shop is in your phone. It's in your pocket. It's in your wife's pocket. Women these days, they get depressed. As soon as she gets depressed, what does she do? Facebook marketplace. Any disturbance, kids give her a hard time. Okay, shut up. And then takes out the phone and yeah, let's buy something. It's a very, very dangerous finger, you know. Not that one shop. Not one, you know. Allah, we're entering a, you know, a light shop or a clothes shop. No, no. Upgrade of dunya. The world at your feet. the world at your disposal, in the comfort of your own bed. Shaitan has reached, my brothers and my sisters, and love of dunya is rampant. But in Rasulullah's time, the markets were still very humble, but yet very dangerous. So when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered the marketplace, everyone is calling for his bada'a. One guy is selling maybe sheep, maybe one guy is selling chicken, maybe one guy is selling, you know, seeds, corn, barley, whatever. And everyone's saying, come, come, ba'ashara gneh, you know, this for $10. You know, if you go to Flemington markets, you know, they get a pallet and everyone's selling something. Oh, I got apples, who would take apple, 99? Similar market. So naturally speaking, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum got distracted. Oh, this. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did the weirdest action ever. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw on the side of the road a dead sheep. A dead sheep. Jadi, asak, mayyit. Asak yani with small defected ears. Yani it's dead and it's defected. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam grabbed the sheep from its defected ears, raised it, and started screaming like the shop sellers. من يشتري مني هذا بدرهم? Who will buy the sheep from a dirham, one silver coin? So every companion that was looking elsewhere, they all looked at the teacher. What happened? What's Rasulullah doing? What are you doing, Ya Rasulullah? What? Everyone focused back and they saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam selling a dead sheep in the market. So they all gathered. The Sahaba realized it's dead. قالوا يا رسول الله وما نفعل به. Am I going to go home to my wife with a dead sheep? أميتة? حبيبتي, I went to the market, alhamdulillah, and I bought you some najasa from the shop. Some filth. What are we doing? Why are you doing this, Rasulullah? So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave them a discount. He dropped the price. Oh, you don't want to pay a dirham? You don't want to pay a silver coin? Alright. Who will take it for free? What you don't want to pay? Is a dirham too much to ask for? Who will take it for free? Who will take it for free? What is Rasulullah doing? Sahaba radiallahu anhum said, O Prophet of Allah, لو كان حيا كان عيبا. If this sheep was alive, it's defected, it has no value. فكيف وهو ميت? How about when it's dead? فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم فوالله للدنيا أهون على الله من هذا عليه. By Allah, dunya is so insignificant in the sight of Allah like this sheep is to your hearts. This, my brothers and my sisters, is what we call a clean heart. So a clean heart, to start off, a heart that is free of the disease of dunya, sees everything in dunya as turab. Like the famous hadith of Haritha, even though it's weak, but the meaning of course is correct. When Muhammad Sallam entered the masjid and saw this young man sleeping in the mosque one day, he bumped into him. فَقَالَ مَنْ? قَالَ حَارِثَ. It's حَارِثَ يا رسول الله. فَقَالَ كَيْفَ أَصْبَحْتَ يَا حَارِثَ? وَحَارِثَ هَذَا, what state have you got up in? فَقَالَ أَصْبَحْتُ مُؤْمِنًا حَقًّا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I have woken up in a real state of iman. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لِكُلِّ قَوْلٍ حَقِيقًا. Every statement has truth, has evidence. فَمَا حَقِيقَةُ إِيمَانِكَ? Every statement that a Muslim makes has to have backup. What is the backup for your statement? So look at the words of Harifa. The hadith is weak, but just understand. فقال يا رسول الله first, the first sign of iman, the first sign of true understanding. فقال يا رسول الله عزفت نفسي عن الدنيا. I have no interest in dunya. يلا let's repent يا شباب, let's start. عزفت نفسي عن الدنيا فاستوى تبرها وترابها. The gold of dunya and the dust of dunya became equal in my heart. I just see turab. Turab. I don't see anything else. I see what? I see turab. If you see other than turab, if you see other than dust, ya haram, your heart is sick. You are one of the sick people. قال عزفت نفسي عن الدنيا فاستوى تبرها وترابها فأسهرت ليلها. When this became my state, I stayed up in its nights. Dunya nights, I'm up in tahajjud. وأظمأت نهارها. And in the mornings, I stayed thirsty in fasting. So fasting in the day and tahajjud at night. فأسهرت ليلها وأظمأت نهارها وأصبحت وكأني أرى عرش ربي بارزا. And I woke up and it is as if I can see the throne and the arsh of Allah in front of my eyes. وأهل الجنة في الجنة يتنعمون. And the people of Jannah enjoying the na'im of Jannah. وأهل النار في النار يتضاوون. And the people of hellfire screaming from the pain of Jahannam and the torture therein. This is the state a true believer woke up in, my brothers and my sisters. Is this our case? Is that your case, ya Habibi? Or are you dunya hungry? Or are you dunya focused? Or are you dunya caring? What happens when dunya comes to your heart? What happens when dunya goes to your heart? What happens when you get ripped off? What happens? What happens if your brother rips you off? What reaction happens in your heart? Imagine me and Zabih are best friends. And I had a bag of sand in my pocket. While I'm sleeping, Zabih came and was give me this sand, man. And I woke up and I saw Zabih took the sand. What am I gonna do, Yani? Take it. It's turab. No, ya Mujahid. No, no, no. No, ya Mujahid. There's some dust outside. CJU59J Toyota Prius. Anyone that gets up after this announcement, brother, all the arrows point at him, brother. Don't do that to yourself. You just choose another time.
The truck there just needs to move a bit forward.
The truck needs to. Please, if this is your car, move it. Someone steals turab from you. Do you get cut? Would you make a fight, you and your brother, over turab? Imagine. Imagine, my brothers. Imagine one day we're dividing turab. We bring to Masjid al-Nur here 1 ton of dust. And I give one guy 50 grams of dust and one guy 1 kilo of dust. Does the 1 kilo guy get happy and the guy with the 50 grams get cut? Brother, take it all, brother. It's all turab. And that's not how we hearts react. Correct? Like, see people in Sufra, sometimes they see food that they didn't eat from an iftar, you know? Sometimes Shakil, last minute, food wasn't enough, so he buys burgers to those who didn't eat. And I see sometimes the faces, yeah, brother. They want to fight, brother, I want to leave the i'tikaf, brother, why? He goes, brother, there's hanky-panky happening. Some people are having curry, some people are having burgers. Over a burger, he wants to leave the i'tikaf. Dunya. Some people, the spot in the masjid. He arrived early, he's smart. He came early to i'tikaf and he bags the corner. You know that corner? The shaitan corner. I call it the shaitan corner in the masjid. Why? Whoever bags that spot, yeah, Baba, no one is going to step over you, no one is going to trip over you at night, you know? You can hide and sleep in salah, no one knows, mashallah. You can miss all the talks. The best spot in Masjid al-Nur. And then sometimes the brother haram goes, he goes to wudu, come back, and finds his bedding air. Let's see, he takes off his abaya, takes off his cap, and he says, Allah, it's on, who? I'll kill him right here. Brother, I came here 3 days early. Over what? Over a spot in the masjid. Why? Because the truth of the matter, my brothers, is our iman. And please don't get upset from me. Our iman is fake. It's not real. It's not Japanese. It's Chinese. Chinese iman. Allah, China now is good, you know. In the old days, you know, when China still wasn't that strong country, our generation were young. There's Japanese quality and there is Chinese quality. Whether this is Chinese or Japanese, so our iman is Chinese. Not real. The iman is in the abaya, iman in the amama, iman in the bead, mashallah. Iman, mashallah, front row. Inside, seek, men and women. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam warned his ummah from this disease. I will share with you a few hadiths that are a bit deep. Look at this incident. We all know the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the amount of sacrifice the Sahaba radiallahu anhum did, the amount of qurbani and effort that each companion sacrificed for the sake of Allah. In Y8, if I remember correctly, Y8, Y7, yani towards the end of the Prophet's life sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the people, the tribe that lived in Bahrain, the existing Bahrain, decided to not wage war with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and pay the jizya. The first ever tribe to accept the authority of Muslims and pay them the tax. We want your protection, we want to pay the tax. So he sallallahu alayhi wasallam sent who? He sent Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu lil Bahrain, ya'ti bi jizyatiha. So Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu went to Bahrain, traveled to Bahrain to bring this money. It's the first money to come to Medina since the day the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam arrived. From the day he arrived, Medina is under complete Arabian Peninsula boycott. Quraysh is upset, bullying all the other tribes, and there's complete boycott on the Ansar. No money comes in, no trade happens, no buying, no selling. So extreme poverty plus double the population. So all the money that used to come went, no more finance, no more tabula, and our population doubled. Years, Badr, war, death, pain, agony, starvation. In the battle of the trench, no food for 2 months. No food. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would send the sariya. Imagine an army. He would send an army, and the soldiers of the army in their trip, every day they get one date. What's your food? What's the food? You get one date a day. One date a day. The Amir of the army divides. Yallahi, take your date and go. That's your food. So the Sahaba said, We used to eat this date, and for the rest of the day we are sucking on the seed. Maybe some juice will come out or something. And then the date's finished. So we miss this date. We were upset about the date, and now we're saying, where is that date? Allah, we're in Na'im. We had a date every day. Starvation for years. Women hungry. Kids hungry. One thing, you suffer hunger. One thing, you watch your own children hungry. No food. And then, after 8 years of suffering, money is coming. إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحِ. You know, alhamdulillah, money is coming. When money comes to the believer, wallahi, I'm telling you, wallahi, it's a very, very, very sad sight. A very sad reaction. Wallahi, we are that addicted to dunya. We are that sick. We love dunya that much that when money comes, we think Allah's pleased with us. Wallahi, when money comes, we think, I must be doing something right. Allah's happy with me. Money is... We identify, we are that sick. We are that blind. We identify the pleasure of Allah by the coming and going of dunya. When money becomes tight, what do we say? I must be doing something. Allah must be displeased with me. Haram. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. So money came. News spread that Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu has arrived. The narrator of this hadith was from Banu Amr ibn Auf, the tribe, the Muslim tribe from the Ansar that lived around Masjid Quba. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had instructed them to continue praying their jama'ah in Quba, which is around 45 minute walk from the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But that Fajr, that morning, all the Musalleen from Quba were in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Everyone from Medina was in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he prayed Fajr sallallahu alayhi wasallam, finished his adhkar, and then was walking to his room. Everyone's waiting. What's happening? So some of them got up and politely stood in the Prophet's way. Where are you going? Where's the ghalla? Where's the division? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam smiled when he saw them. You know, they don't usually pray here, they pray in Quba. So when he saw them, he smiled. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ سَمِعْتُمْ أَنَّ أَبَا عُبَيْدَ قَدْنَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ. You must have heard the news that Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu has come with some money from Bahrain. So the Sahaba nodded to him. You understand the situation, Ya Rasulullah. Starvation. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَبْشِرُوا. Good news. He has arrived. أَبْشِرُوا وَأَمِّلُوا مَا يَسُرُّكُمْ. Good, good. Be happy. Be excited. Have hope. Have hopes. Have dreams. فَوَاللَّهِ. By Allah. فَوَاللَّهِ. مَا الْفَقْرَ أَخْشَى عَلَيْكُمْ. It is not poverty I fear for you. The nightmare of every Muslim. Every Muslim has a nightmare. Poverty. فَوَاللَّهِ. مَا الْفَقْرَ أَخْشَى عَلَيْكُمْ. وَلَكِنْ أَخْشَى. I am worried. I am fearful. I am scared for my ummah. وَلَكِنْ أَخْشَى أَن تُبْسَطَ عَلَيْكُمُ الدُّنْيَا. I am worried that Allah will send you money. Allah will give you dunya. When you are poor, I'm happy. When you are poor, you are safe. But if dunya comes, ولكن أخشى أن تبسط عليكم الدنيا كما بسطت على الذين من قبلكم. Like dunya was given to the nations before you. What will happen when dunya comes? What will happen? فتنافسوها كما تنافسوها. You will start competing in dunya, like the nations before you competed in dunya. فتهلككم كما أهلكتهم. Dunya will destroy your deen. These are not my words. I'm not giving you my opinion. I'm not sharing with you my thoughts. These are the exact words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dunya comes, dunya will destroy you and your family. But these are foreign words. You will not hear this. This is taboo, taboo. Don't talk about this. Because the Sheikh himself usually has a lot of dunya. What's he going to say? Once we were in Khuruj, in South Africa. And we're doing ta'lim in the morning. These are the excited days, you know. I had a little bit more energy. And I was smashing the boys about Zuhud, you know. Maybe 3 hour session in the morning. Bang, bang, bang. Dunya, brother, fitna. The boys wanted to take off the, you know, khalas. If he has a good abaya, he wants to put on an ikaf or something. And then that day we were invited for lunch. So one of the big sheikhs in South Africa, he took us to his house. Not house, it was a mansion. And he gave us lunch over a huge swimming pool. The boys, ya haram, they've just had 3 hour session about Zuhud. And now the old worker of the city, the Maulana of the city, is inviting them to his mansion. So as soon as the boys walked in, they all, of course, no conversation, no words. But they all looked at me, you little idiot. Oh. Where do you bring these theories from, you know? What the hell are you teaching us? Look! There's three top of the range mercs parked in the front. Servants, security, swimming pool, maybe 20 rooms in the house, you know? And food, bah, not food like the food we eat in Khuruj. No, no, okay, we're talking now. 10 star. Food better than to eat at home. And then the boys, this is the good sheikh. Why are you like that? That's a sheikh that understands. But look, brother, there's nothing wrong with it, man. Wallah, man, why are you torturing us? Why can't I have a big house, nice swimming pool, you know, nice car? Why? Allah, I don't know what to say to you, man. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. I don't know what to say. Very, very hard. You're right. What a one. This is why when I say a hadith like these, I feel a bit of relief. No one can say, wallah, these are Umar theories. No one can say, ah, look, Umar's opinion. Did you hear what Muhammad SAW said? Did you hear what I said? These are his words. The hadith is muttafaq alayhi, Bukhari and Muslim. These are his words. By Allah, it is not poverty I fear for you. I fear that dunya will come and you will compete and it will destroy you and destroy your deen. Whose fees are right and wrong, my brothers and my sisters? Whose fees are justified? Your fear of poverty? Your nightmare? My financial security? Baba, I need to buy a house every, you know? Religious tablighi, brother, you know? Deen dar, mashallah. Deen wala. 4 months every year. 4 months. Sacrifice, da'wah, tahajjud, Quran. Comes to dunya. And he fails. He buys a house for his son. What are you buying a house for your son for? I want him to be comfortable. I want him to worship Allah properly. The exact opposite of what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying. Yani not less in the same direction. No. Black and white. This direction, that direction. The Prophet of Allah is saying, I am worried money will come. And this guy wants to give his kids a lot of money to protect their deen. Do you understand how stuffed this ummah is? Do you understand how corrupted our hearts and brains are? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahmatullah alayhi, the fifth Khalifa Rashid, we call him, khamis al-khulafa al-rashidin. Imagine, yani from Ali, we jump to who? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiyallahu anhu. This man was a Khalifa, Khalifa. Don't worry about your money. You think you have money, you're a shahat, you're a beggar. You're poor. This guy was the Khalifa for Banu Umayyah. Billions of dollars, author, real king. But his heart was attached to the hereafter. Dunya meant dust. So on his deathbed, he had one son, one better. And he is Amir al-Mu'mineen. On his deathbed, he gave and left his son nothing. In his will, in his wasiyah, no inheritance. Exactly like who? Like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did he leave behind? Which house? How much money in the bank? How much? Does anyone know? How much money? You don't know, or you know and you don't want to say? Huh? How much?
Zero.
Zero. Zero. Zero. Nothing. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz followed through. Zero. So when his advisors found out, they wanted to intervene. Haram, this young boy. Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, aren't you going to leave anything for your son? So Umar ibn Aziz said these words. He said, if my son is a pious man, and I hope he is, I taught him connection with Allah, then he does not need my money. When he wants money, he will ask Allah and Allah will give him. If I brought him up correctly, he doesn't need my money. When he wants money, Allah will give him. And if my son is corrupt and I did not teach him properly, and I could not teach him yaqeen and iman and dua to solve his own dunya problems, then I ask you by Allah, is it logical to give money to a corrupt person? I'm going to give money to a bad guy? I failed in his tarbiyah, I couldn't. I'm going to give him money now to spend it in the wrong way? No, thank you. If he's good, he doesn't need me. But this is, that's foreign, that's not Chinese. That's a different language. You will never hear this. You will only hear, brother, spend on your family. Spending on your family is good. Leave your family, mashallah, rich. Because when Muhammad said these words, he meant buy him a $50,000 car and buy him, mashallah, a nice $1 million house. $1 million. $1 million, thousands of families, thousands of human beings will live for 1 year, father, wife, and children with this money. Thousands. And you just want to walk in it like that, Why? My house. I don't want to rent. I don't want to move every 6 months. What kind of humiliation and torture is this? Wallah al-Azim, uqsim billahi al-Azim, there is nothing in Australia that is better than the concept of rent. I'm telling you now, rent is a na'im, it's a blessing. And the shorter the period, even better. If they throw you out every 6 months, they're protecting you and your family's iman. When you rent a house, your wife comes and says, oh please, didn't you promise you will build this pergola for me? I said, Habibti, but you know, by the time I finish it, they will ask us to leave.
Okay.
Oh, can we please renovate the kitchen? There's nothing wrong with the kitchen, Habibti. Wallah, it cooks like every other kitchen. The $20,000 kitchen and the $1,000 kitchen from Bunnings, Uqsim Billah, they do the same job. The food comes out the same. But love of dunya. Let's renovate the kitchen. Every single Muslim now has become a gardener. Find, mashallah, a guy with beard and that. You go visit him at home and you find him, mashallah, wearing the Bunnings overall, and he's planting limoon and planting oranges, and he wants to show you his trees, and he's growing cucumbers now and growing tomatoes. Halas, you left the humum of the ummah, you left the million and one problems of the ummah, and you're focused now on growing your own produce. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. The direction is wrong. The fikr is wrong. The focus is wrong. On average, my brothers and my sisters, on average, each and every one of us, I'm telling you now, if you don't believe me, if you don't believe that you are a dunya person, do some statistics. Do yourself a favor. See how much time and effort and money and brain power do you spend on dunya? How much? How much of you does dunya suck? Between work and wife and kids and shopping and gym and whatever it is, and eating and drinking and buying, how much of you does dunya suck? I'm telling you now, on average, dunya will eat up 95% of your resources. If you are a 90% Muslim, make dua for me. You're a good Muslim in our time. If you hit 90% only, you're improving. 95% plus is dunya. We can't even pray two raka'at without thinking of dunya. This is how much the addiction is. You can't even stand in front of Rabbul Alameen, your Khaliq, say Allahu Akbar, throw dunya behind you and focus for 10 minutes. You can't. You will start good, and before you know it, dunya will creep to your heart. Wife, kids, work, you know, food, clothes. Wallahi, wallahi. Our hearts are sick, my brothers and my sisters. Every one of us, as I famously say, has a young baby Qarun inside us. Remember baby Qarun? Every one of us, from outside, he looks like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But on the inside, he has a young little cute Qarun. Dunya lover. Loves money. Loves status. Loves image. Loves boasting his dunya. That's why people buy brands. Which idiot, my brothers, will go buy an expensive watch? People buy watches to tell time? Is your watch in your hand now? Did you buy this watch to tell you time? Is that why you have a watch? I don't want to look at the watches, I don't want to say anything. You don't buy a watch to tell time. You want to tell time, Habibi, $10. You tell time. Your phone tells time. You buy a watch, why? Why do I watch as a bin? Huh? The disease of the religious brothers. Not the non-religious brothers. No. Non-religious brothers are drinking alcohol, smoking pot, you know, taking drugs. But if you're on deen now, you're not gonna do that. But that's your disease. Assalamu alaikum, brothers. Assalamu alaikum. You go and buy a $5,000, $10,000 watch. $10,000 to tell time? No. I didn't pay $10,000 to know the time. I paid $10,000 because I want to make a statement. A statement exactly like the statement of Qarun. I'm not anybody. I am someone. I have style. I know fashion. We have Muslim sisters now in niqab. But her job, wallahi, I'm not joking. Her job is called fashionista. Have you heard this new bid'ah word? She's a fashionista. What's a fashionista? Sounds like fascista, you know, fascism or something. No, fashionista is the sister that's not just religious. She's religious, but she's also fashionable. She understands the trends. She knows how to make Islam not dull. Yeah, you can wear your hijab, sister, but your hijab has to make a statement about your personality and your character. Doesn't mean you have to look ugly and like a, you know, like a ninja. No. Some pink, some yellow, some, you know, in summer flowery, and in winter, you know, the deep blue, and you know, have to, you know, impress baby Qarun. Baby Qarun is residing inside the heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the amazing surah of Qasas, speaks to us about this sick man. Allah is not talking to Bani Israel. When you read the story of Qarun, remember, Allah is talking to you. Allah is not telling you bedtime stories. Hey, little kids, cute Muslims, we are going to tell you the story of bad, big bad Qarun, you know? What a bad man who lived in the past. No, Allah is talking to your heart, to you, ya Marid. Allah is trying, Quran is trying to heal your heart from the sickness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ قَارُونَ كَانَ مِنْ قَوْمِ مُوسَى فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ. Qarun was from Bani Israel. Qarun wasn't a kafir. Qarun was from Bani Israel. He wasn't an Egyptian. إِنَّ قَارُونَ كَانَ مِنْ قَوْمِ مُوسَى فَبَغَى عَلَيْهِمْ. But he was a baghi. He transgressed the boundaries of Allah. وَآتَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْكُنُوزِ ما إن مفاتحه لتنوء بالعصبة أولي القوة. We gave him that much money that the keys of the safes of his treasures, a strong group of men, عصبة يعني from 3 to 9 men, strong men can't carry the box that has the keys of the safes of Qarun. Yani Uncle Scrooge times 200. Look at the words of Allah. Don't say Umar al-Banna said, go home, forget about me, and read Ya Habibi in English, Quran in English. What is Allah saying? إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ قَوْمُهُ. The good people of Bani Israel said to him what? لا تفرح. What? لا تفرح. Don't be happy. Why? I'm happy. Why do you make me sad? Anyone, any Muslim, male or female, who gets happy with the incoming of dunya is sick with the love of dunya. He has cancer. You are a cancer patient. Not just cancer. You have cancer and AIDS and Ebola and COVID all together. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ قَوْمُهُ لَا تَفْرَحْ. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ. Allah does not love. Are you hearing? Are you with me or you're tired? خلاص. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ. Allah does not love happy people. Can that be the explanation? So if I'm happy, Allah is not pleased with me?
No.
Allah does not love people who get happy with dunya. If the reason of your happiness is dunya, then Allah does not love you. Think repentance. Come back to me. If you get happy when money comes, you are a dunya junkie. You need to go to rehab. We need to send you on a 5-year khuruj. Not 4 months. Because this is the disease of 4 months. They will go 4 months and come back and buy a mansion with a pool. You need 5 years, 10 years khuruj plus. For dunya to come out of the heart. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ قَوْمُهُ لَا تَفْرَحْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْفَرِحِينَ. Allah does not love people who get happy with their dunya. وَبْتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Use whatever, look at deen. Use whatever money Allah blessed you with in your akhirah project. That's how you use the money. Not make your dunya better. Don't go buy mansions and go buy cars and things of dunya. No. Rather use the money Allah gives you in your goal and target of akhirah. Spend it fi sabilillah. وَبْتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. And your ammi, take for your dunya whatever has been shown by the prophets of Allah. The balance. The right. Normal fitrah need of the son of Adam, like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us. وَبْتَغِ فِي مَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ الدَّارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Like Allah bless you and gave you, give people في سبيل الله. وَلَا تَبْغِ الْفَسَادَ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Don't cause corruption on earth. Allah does not love or is pleased with those who cause corruption on earth. And whenever you advise a rich man about his wealth and love of dunya, what happens? See, now I'm giving you a talk. I'm not addressing anyone individually. So your guards are down. And maybe some of my words are reaching the heart, because no one is being targeted. But if I was to talk to any of you individually, say, brother, you know what? You, brother, wallah, written all over you, dunya lover. All over you, from top to bottom, dunya lover. You and your wife and your kids, dunya lovers. Qarun and Qarun's wife and young baby Qarun's at home. The guard comes up straight away. Defense, anger, frustration. People can't handle being told they're wrong. Go tell anyone, brother, you're a dunya slave. What? Me, dunya, brother, wallah, I don't care about dunya one little bit. Every dunya addict says the same words, subhanallah. It's like they teach each other. Wallahi, I can't tell you how many brothers around me. I can see all the signs of dunya addiction. I'm one of them. Don't get me wrong. So don't, the sheikh is wallah. I'm one of them. But I can see all the signs of dunya addiction. And when we talk about it, the brother is in complete denial. Like there's no even doubt. Like, you know, like I'm thinking, brother, wallahi, we need to go to rehab. And this guy is saying, brother, wallahi, you know, see all this dunya, I don't care about it. But subhanallah, the other day, one brother took $10 extra off him and he boycotted him. Brother, how come you and this guy? He goes, I will never speak to him again in my life. Why? Brother, wallahi, we start a business together. Do you believe it? He ripped me off 10 bucks. Wallah, I don't care about $10. It's principle, brother. Principle, you know? Wallah, family members don't talk. What? Husband will curse his wife because she wants his dunya. Wife will curse her husband because he's not giving her dunya. Kids will curse their parents because they're not giving them dunya. Everyone is fighting over dunya with his teeth, but then they completely deny that they are addicts. Well, brother, me? Allah, I don't care, brother. People are in the last 10 days of Ramadan, he's not in i'tikaf because he's a dunya slave. But he can't see he's a dunya slave. He can't see it. People are begging Allah for acceptance and this guy is still chasing money. Every single day, maybe 45 weeks of the year, 6 days, 5 days a week, 8 hours a day, 10 hours a day, direct chasing dunya. Upgrade in lifestyle, upgrade in things, brands, and religious competition, silent religious competition. You know when do you see it? You know when do you see the people of money? When the mashayikh come from overseas. When mashayikh come from overseas, we always find the religious brothers appearing in the masjid. They want to do ikram. They want to mashallah. Brother, where were you when we were feeding the poor students? When we were feeding the students, ya haram, they actually need the money. They need the food. Where were you? Now all of a sudden the mashayikh are here. Your money comes out and you want to show your, you know, $1 million car, and you want to make sure that the mashayikh come to your $1 million house. Brother, if you believe that these are real mashayikh, if this is what really you believe, then brother, they don't care. Allah al-Azim, you go, when you used to go to the markaz, Mawlana Ibrahim, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserve him. You know? I don't know how to describe, you know? Wallahi, wallahi, wallahi. You go and enter this guy's room. There was a small room like that, with one tiny bed, and there's nothing in the room. I'm telling you now, I'm a big, big, big critic. Like, I'm sick in the heart. This is the sickness of mashayikh. You don't know this sickness, maybe some of you. Mashayikh are sick, especially me. I have this ajib sickness. What is the sickness? As soon as you see any sheikh other than you, what happens? What happens? You see any sheikh, you wanna kill him inside your brain. You know what I mean? You with me or not? You see another sheikh, you don't say, ah, mashallah, goodbye. Of course, that's what we say on our tongues. You know, mashallah, brother, give me a hug. But in the heart, what's happening? Like, the guy's a hypocrite, man. Like, look at the car he's driving, man. Like, oh, he didn't pray. Only, what, Ramadan, two rak'ahs? Come to Masjid Noor, brother. You wanna rip him. In your mind, you wanna rip him to feel comfortable, to shine inside you. Disease, marad. So I went to this guy's room with the intention of finding him. I'm not going there because I love him. I'm going there because I want to but these are the mashayikh, you know? Look. Wallah, you enter the room. Guy is 80 something years old. And he's, I'm telling you, his pillow, I won't put my head on it. I won't put my head on this pillow. Nothing in the room. Nothing. Abaya, nothing. Sometimes curry stains. No, you find curry spots. Simple life. And you go to other mashayikh and ulama, mashallah, students and AMG, and he's wearing a Rolex watch, and mashallah, his, you know, his abaya is more expensive than my car. The cloak he's wearing is more expensive than my car. His amama, he gets made specially in Lebanon. Cost him, you know, $500. Special made. Amama in Egypt or in Lebanon. And then you can't help but see, you know? Subhanallah. May Allah Azza wa Jal guide us, my brothers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clean our hearts. So Qarun, when advised, it hurt him. Defense came. What do you mean? What do you mean, dunya, I'm a dunya lover? So he said, إِنَّمَا أُوتِيتُهُ عَلَىٰ عِلْمٍ عِنْدِي. Ah, you are some of those people, you know, all religious people keep saying, ah, Allah is Razzaq, Allah is Razzaq. Brother, I'm smart, brother, I'm intelligent, I worked hard, this is hard earned money. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَوَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَهْلَكَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ مِنَ الْقُرُونِ مَنْ هُوَ أَشَدُّ مِنْهُ قُوَّةً وَأَكْثَرُ جَمْعًا. Doesn't Qarun know that Allah has destroyed before him people who are more rich, had more money, more wealth, more strength? وَلَا يُسْأَلُ عَنْ ذُنُوبِهِمُ الْمُجْرِمُونَ. So Qarun, when he got caught, he did what we do now as Muslims. What did he do? فَخَرَجَ عَلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فِي زِينَتِهِ. He put his wardrobe on. He gathered the best of his clothes. He decked himself with his rings and his gold and whatever cloak he was wearing, and his entourage and his people. فَخَرَجَ عَلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فِي زِينَتِهِ. Yeah, you wanna come advise me? Look at what I have and you don't. قال الذين يريدون الحياة الدنيا. Those who don't have like Qarun, but are young Qaruns, they would love to have what Qarun has. قال الذين يريدون الحياة الدنيا يا ليت لنا مثل ما أوتي قارون. Raise your hand if you are like that. What's wrong with you? Raise your hand. Start healing. Raise your hand. Say after me. I am a baby Qarun. Say it.
I am a baby Qarun.
Practice. I am a baby Qarun. Actually, Qarun haram didn't have Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam as his prophet. I even worse. I have Quran. I have Rasulullah, and I still don't believe. Baby Qaruns, dunya lovers. We love dunya. We love status. We love brands. We love things of dunya. Allah said, قَالَ الَّذِينَ يُرِيدُونَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. Dunya lovers, when they saw Qarun, what did they say? They're all Muslim. These are not kuffar. These are Bani Israel people. يَا لَيْتَ لَنَا مِثْلَ مَا أُوتِيَ قَارُونَ إِنَّهُ لَذُو حَظٍ عَظِيمٍ. Oh my God, if I can only have like this bugger. When you see a nice car, what comes to your heart? When you go to a brother's house, and find, mashallah, a mansion, sometimes the haram, your brother invites you and your family to his house. So you take your wife, and as soon as you see the house, you say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. I'm going home to a big fight. I'm going home to depression, Why? Haram, my wife is living in rent. She when we buy something, we buy second-hand couches. And we're trying, to explain that we are in Na'im, and look at the people of Gaza, and look at the people of Palestine. And then she comes, mashallah, to your house, my brother, and she finds, mashallah, $10,000 couches, and the kitchen, mashallah, is like this. And the backyard is like that. And the sister, mashallah, also wears niqab and goes to Umrah and goes khuruj and does deen, mashallah. And the question that comes to any heart is, why is my husband shaitan al-rajim? Why am I the only wife that has this type of husband? Why can't we, be religious but also have a mansion? Why do we have to live in rent? Why do we have to live simple? Why do we have to live in tiny room? Why can't brother, mashallah? And you don't know what to say. You have to, if I try, sometimes, in the past, when I tried to give this talk at home, I don't finish 5 minutes. It turns into an argument. This is why, I can speak in the masjid. No one cuts me off. I get my chance. But you think Sheikh can talk like this at home?
I'm telling you, man.
Within 5 minutes. Subhanallah. That's the only sunnah you want to talk about, huh? It turns into a debate straight away because she knows I'm targeting her.
Why? No.
Love of dunya, my brothers. Love of dunya. Love of dunya is rampant. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the people who wanted and loved what Qarun had. Just that. Just that. They're not sinners. They're not alcoholics. They're not drug dealers. They are not, they don't watch haram. No, no, no. All what these people did is what? His heart, her heart, wanted what Qarun? They believed Qarun is a lucky man. إِنَّهُ لَذُو حَظٍ عَظِيمٍ وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمِ But those who have knowledge, real knowledge, not graduate from this jami'ah or this madrasa, no, no. Those who have real knowledge, when they heard people say Qarun is lucky, they lost it. They got angry. وَيْلَكُمْ Woe to you! ثواب الله خير لمن آمن وعمل صالحا. They can't see dunya. They see turab. Baba, akhira is much better. That's iman and that's shirk والعياذ بالله. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punished Qarun and he ordered the earth to swallow him and his wealth. Everything gone. The earth swallowed Qarun and his palace and his money. فهو يتجلجل في الأرض إلى يوم القيامة. The earth continues to swallow Qarun until judgment day. He doesn't rest. Every day he's being swallowed deeper. He runs around the earth. فخسفنا به وبداره الأرض. فما كان له من فئة ينصرونه من دون الله وما كان من المنتصرين. وأصبح الذين تمنوا مكانه بالأمس. And those who wished to be like Qarun yesterday, when they woke up and found no house and no money, what did they say? وَأَصْبَحَ الَّذِينَ تَمَنَّوا مَكَانَهُ بِالْأَمْسِ يَقُولُونَ وَيْكَأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ وَيَقْدِرُ What the prophets are saying is true. This rizq is from Allah, comes, goes. Doesn't mean anything. Doesn't have any effect on your deen, on your akhirah. وَيْكَأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ وَيَقْدِرُ لَوْلَا أَمَّنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا لَخَسَفَ بِنَا فَاللَّهُ didn't bless us, we also deserve to be swallowed by the earth. We are sick, my brothers. And we have to repent from this sickness. We have to treat this sickness. We have to learn how to change our focus and our love, and our attachment, and our worry, and our priority. We have to learn how to shift this from dunya to akhirah. We want our worries to be acceptance by Allah, not acceptance by my new job interview. We want to learn how to be happy when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows me to pray 2 rak'at of tahajjud. That you know you feel mashallah worth making shukr to Allah Azza wa Jal, not because of dunya coming or dunya going. You have to learn how to feel pain when your deen decreases. You miss an opportunity of deen, your pain should be killing you, not when dunya goes, because dunya, my brothers, is turab. Turab goes, turab comes. We have to learn how to avoid brands and status competition and caring and looking at people's dunya and comparing ourselves. Who has better? Who has more? Who's more fashionable? Who does a fashion statement? And who does this and who does that? All of these are diseases that are the diseases of religious brothers and sisters. Why do women hate niqab? Women hate niqab, especially black solid niqab. Why do they hate it? because it kills the female identity. صح ولا لا؟ Kills it. Kills it. Kills it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designed society as such where a Muslim female, when she leaves her home, no one can tell who's who. She's in the protection of her hijab. No perfume, no zina, no makeup, black. كأنهن الغربان. They walk on the street, they come, they go, and any man, even the hungry eye, the hungry, lusty eye, can't find anything to please. You know, he's looking at a wall, ya haram. It's dark from top to bottom. You say, you explain this to a sister and she insults her, she's dying. So maybe she puts on the niqab, but she wants to wear a Chanel bag to the masjid. Sister, what are you doing? You're exactly now like a clown who has a red nose and a blue, you know, and a pink backside and a, you know, The whole point of niqab is to make you all look the same. To make no statement, no attraction of attention on the street. You and every other sister look the same. Like ihram clothes, you know? There's no this and that. There's no wallah. No, some sisters, no. Have you heard of the niqab fringe? You don't know the niqab fringe? You're out of fashion, man. You're late. Some sisters, they buy the three-layer niqab. There's one layer that's designed to cover the eyes, you know, for the pious sisters. They want to cover the eyes because كم في المحاجر من خناجر, as Imam Al-Adru'i said, you know, the eyes, yeah, Baba, what the eyes do. So some sisters, they buy the three-layer niqab, but she doesn't want to cover her eyes because, you know, she needs to see. But really, the gap is big. It's not about seeing, it's about, oh man, something. And she does a fringe with the third layer. She has a niqab fringe. She's walking the street. What are you doing? Or shoes, or a bag, or, you know, a watch. Anything and anything to just give it some kick. Or a abaya, a black abaya, but you find the line of, you know, sparkles here. I just don't want to be normal. I want to be, you know. This is why Aisha radiallahu anha, عجيب حديث عجيب أم المؤمنين رضي الله عنها. She said in the famous hadith, and this lady is the lady the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, خذوا نصف دينكم من هذه الحميراء. Take half of your deen from this lady. Knowledgeable, young. عائشة رضي الله عنها used to say, لو علم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أحدث النساء بعده. If the Prophet of Allah was to know what women have done after he passed away, لمنعهن المساجد كما منعت نساء بني إسرائيل. He would have banned them from going to the masjid. That's when did this fitna happen? When? 1400 years ago. So imagine if Muhammad Sallam was to come in our time and find, mashallah, our beautiful pious sisters wearing the pink flowery jilbabs and hijabs, sitting in coffee shops in massive groups and giggling. Yeah. And they're talking to this guy and the barista, and the barista knows her coffee. When she arrives, the sister, she doesn't have to say, I only drink coffee from this place because my barista knows my coffee. I'm not talking about the sisters that are far away from deen. I'm talking about the sisters, mashallah. Her husband's in 4 months khuruj. And she's, mashallah, built a relationship with her barista. You know? I only drink from his hands, mashallah. Because, you know, breakfast and this and outings and long story, my brothers. All signs and symptoms of very, very, very big disease called the love of dunya. Please, my brothers, please, my sisters, in the 10 days, before Eid. Repent from this path. Beg Allah in your sujood, in the long salah of tahajjud, before iftar. Beg Allah and cry to take the love of dunya out of your heart and make your heart a heart that is focused on the hereafter. Care about what Allah thinks. Teach your heart to worry about Allah's view of you, not what people think of you. Their opinion, the way they look at you, Allah, he means nothing. But Allah Azza wa Jal means everything. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك. جزاكم الله خيرا وبارك الله فيك.